working on by giving it context, by talking about their past work, maybe showing you images, really giving, preparing you for what you're gonna see. Then they share a new work in development, in process. And then we also have invited a critical respondent, and that's a very open term. It can be an essayist, it can be an artist, it can be a thinker, a philosopher, it can be anyone at all. And in this case, Che Gossett, who is an archivist and a scholar, has been connecting with the artists who you did not know for this process, and who will be here to offer their own critical response to the work in this moment. And again, the aim is not to critically deconstruct the work, but to trace some thread or idea. Is that a fair way to say it? Great. And then we'll also have an opportunity to talk and have a bit of a conversation with you all. So that's it, and I'll turn it over to the artists. Thank you so much.
My name is Stella Itzikada. I'm a theater maker and performer coming from Japan.
I'm a filmmaker, theater maker, and I was born in Indiana.
We met about 7 years ago in a festival. I was performing in it.
I was documenting it.
And that's how I met. That's how we met. And a few years later, Nikki popped an email to me saying, "Hey, do you want to make something with me?" So I said, "Yeah, let's make something." So we decided to make something together. And
we got together.
Right, but we didn't know each other so well. So we were just talking to just find out who you are, who I am, and what do you like, what do you want to do? And then we discovered that both of us like silent film. So, okay, let's make a silent film together first, then see what happens.
So then the next part was, so what's the story? What's the content of the silent film? What do we put in it? And again, as we didn't know each other, we would meet, we would talk, and suddenly one of those talks sort of turned into an interview where I was sort of deeply asking questions and interviewing Sari specifically too about her, how she came to America.
Well, you kind of decided that this is going to be about my life, coming to America. And I said, but we didn't really have a better idea at the time. So, okay, let's start with that and see what happens. So she interviewed me about my life. And we sat down in a Whole Foods lounge for about 2 hours. And I told her what happened, how I came to the United States. And I even showed her my diary at the time and the facts that I sent to my parents with illustrations describing what my life in New York is like. So, and that includes a story about me coming to New York. Well, the reason why I came to the United States is basically because I had a big breakup with my boyfriend in Japan at the time, who introduced me to the theater world. He was my world, but it broke down, and my future was broken down in pieces, so I had to go away. So I decided to go to New York, and with no money, no English, and nobody to rely on. So I bought a one-way ticket to New York, and couldn't really tell my parents how long it's gonna be and what am I gonna be doing and what's my plan. I didn't have any plans, so I couldn't answer. But I went anyway. Then I landed with no English and $300 in my Citibank account. So I needed a job right away, and I needed a place to stay. I found this horrendous hotel called Riverside Hotel. It was full of junkies and drug dealers and cockroaches, and it was scary and wild. But I stayed, and I found this job on I saw this ad on a free paper saying Club Diamond looking for girls, and oh, needed in a job is an immediate cash, weekly cash pay, because I really didn't have anything. And I needed to be fed. And I needed, I didn't have anything, so they said costume providers. Okay, perfect. And I went to the interview, and I got the job, and I started from that night on. And in this place, Club Diamond, is a funny place. It's sort of like, it's run by Japanese people in Midtown East. And they call it a piano bar, but there's no piano. It's basically a gentleman's club-like idea, but there's no touching. And so what I was hired to do, amongst other girls, is to dress up nicely with a tight dress and pretty, be pretty, and then sit down with the clientele and pour their drinks and light their cigarettes and carry out a wonderful conversation to make them feel like there's the best thing in the world. So that's what I did for cash. And that is the part of this New York story that I didn't tell to my parents. I edited it out.
So I thought, wow, this is a great silent film. And we're going to tell the story set in 1920s black and white film about a young Japanese woman who comes to America to be a big star. So we've created a piece called Club Diamond. And Club Diamond is that story told four different ways. One is the 1927 silent black and white silent film, part one layer. The second layer is Japan has a tradition called the benshi. And benshi were the narrators of silent film. And these guys were often bigger than the stars of the film themselves. They would speak the parts, they would do Foley, like fake sound effects, they would gossip, they would tell you everything about the affairs that people were having on set. And so everyone came really to see the benshis. And then she sat at the side of the film and would narrate, because often the films were coming from Britain or Japan, so that she could make up anything they wanted about the story. So that's sort of layer two of the story being told of the Japanese, is the benshi over there. And then layer three is 10 years later in 1947, where many of the benshi, all the benshi really, had lost their jobs to the talkies. And we're also in American-occupied Japan. So there's another tradition in Japan called kamishibai, which translates as paper play. So guys would go on their bicycles with a little mini stage on the back with candies, and they would give candies to the kids, ring the bell, the kids would all gather around, and they would open up this little mini stage, and on it were drawings. So it was like an episodic storytelling, and this was really the beginning of comic books and manga. So that's sort of layer three. And then layer four was Sowery in 2017, telling the story of coming to America, what she did and didn't tell her parents. So that's what Club Diamond, the piece that we made. So imagine, if you will, I'm going to show you a little excerpt, that on this side of the stage is the fabulous composer and violinist Tim Fain, who did the music for the piece and also played live violin into the score. And here we are on the benchy, and we're in 1937.
はい、皆さん、横浜シネマ大西洋ございました。本日、クラブダイヤモンドのエキスアプツをご披露いたします。本日のベンチ、スカダテでございます。いやいやいやいや、とも。それでは、without further ado ということで、ニキさん、ジャックさん、GO! Thank you. Thank you. what happened next? This is not exactly what happened to me. It's a very dramatic version of what I experienced. And it's the part of my life that I edited out to my parents. What happens after this in Club Diamond is that the film gets tangled up and breaks and burns. The film burns and the story burns. Only the facts, Mickey, only the facts. Okay? 17 years ago, you said there are three things that happened to you. Fire, the death, the betrayal. Let's begin with fire.
Okay, I was living in Seattle with my partner Karen about 7 years ago. I mean, we've been together about 7 years. And in a building called the Willana. And in May of 2001, there was a fire that took out about 8 units. One was mine, the unit we lived in together.
And are you at home when the fire happened?
No, at the time I was actually in Pennsylvania. My mom had been sick with breast cancer for a long time and she was in the last stages. She passed away about 7 days after the fire.
So how did you know about the fire?
I got a call from Karen's two friends, Nancy and Jenny Mao. They told me that Karen was okay. She was in my apartment, but she was fine. She wasn't hurt, but she was medicated. So, because I knew my mother was dying, it was a big sort of dilemma about whether to stay there in Pennsylvania, whether to come back, whether to bring her out. And after a lot of consultation with friends, I decided to stay.
When did you go back to your apartment?
So, then it was a funeral. And then I came back about 10 days later to a bed and breakfast across the street. I had good insurance, so they put me up over there.
What happened to your stuff? Did it get burned?
Yeah, most of my stuff was burned, and I recommend insurance. I had good insurance, and an adjuster came. They called them the adjuster, so the adjuster came into the apartment, and I think no matter how burned things are, their job is to actually write down and somehow document every single object that you own, from the most expensive stereo to literally the condiments in the refrigerator. So I was delivered a document that's about 40 something pages long, with about 40 to 50 items per page, from ketchup to mustard and capers, with two columns afterwards which were either cashing out. So I would get like 3 cents for the capers, or I could rebuy the capers. So both of those sort of tallied up into a number that was the worth of my belongings.
Great. Nikki, this is going to be our next piece.
Great.
Club Diamond was based on my story, and it was painful. This time, it's going to be her story. Now, and there's another thing that she told me that inspired me and us, and that we want to incorporate with this new piece. She had this encounter, a very interesting encounter with this person she's going to describe, when she was doing a research for
a documentary
film that you're making.
Yeah, so I think that first conversation got us into talking about value and the value and stuff and our belongings and how we value them. And, And then the second piece that I was telling her is I was working on a documentary about one of the Tibetans that came over when the Dalai Lama left in 59 and was part of a Rockefeller Young Scholars program that brought a group of these monks. They were all, they just graduated, they just got their geisha degree, which is a PhD in their monastery system, and in the 60s, and brought them to America. And someone who I've known for 25 years and studied with came and I was doing a documentary about him. I had a friend who said, oh, I know these guys, they're just about to open the Rockefeller archive up in Tarrytown, and you can go up. And I was like, oh, fantastic. So I took the train up, went to this huge building that was pretty much empty. It wasn't open yet. These two guys were like, sit here, just wait for a minute, and he'll be right with you. And so then down the aisle in this very dark, like basement-like, giant hallway place came this guy. And this guy was about 5'2". He was probably in his mid to late 60s. He had a big brown ill-fitting suit on, and his hair was all kind of this. And he had a big giant cart full of every piece of the Rockefeller archive that he could find related to this Young Scholars Program, and in fact found Gaelic Rinpoche was his name, and found the ledgers that had been written, and the telegram that had been written to India that said, send the monks. And so I got to spend the day with an archivist.
Amazing.
Part two.
So let's make an animation film about this guy. Let's make a little puppet piece of this archivist guy in the underground library. That's gonna be our piece. So, in Club Diamond, we had a silent film, and we wanted the music to be really romantic, really techy, but good violin music. So we asked our friend Tim Feng, who is an incredible violinist and composer, to compose the music to the silent film, and he performed live on stage with us too. For this time, for Archivist, what do we want for this animation film?
Cello.
And we happen to know this wonderful cellist, Ruben Codelli. Ladies and gentlemen.
Song where I come from, I was born in Albania, so it's a folk song from Albania. And it's a love song. There's no particular title, it's just a love song.
Beautiful. Thank you.
So I don't know. I think every artist's process is different in terms of how they make things and how they bring things together. So we're starting to really, we're in the early phases of this piece, and so we're bringing together a couple of ideas, one of which really is archiving and value and how we value the things we have, and we're in such an interesting digital age of how you keep things and how time affects value. And so, yeah.
And he just joined us like yesterday. I mean, we asked him before, and then he said yes. So, but we didn't really have material to share for like a film for him to score yet. So we kind of explained the rough idea, but it was on the hold for a while. And yesterday he joined and said, "Hey, can you do something with us?" So there he is. And we just gave him a little clue about what we were thinking about in terms of what we were interested in about the theme of archiving, the value of things, how do a thing get evaluated by who, and how whose story makes a value of a thing, that sort of thing. And yesterday you mentioned something about, as a musician, like archiving, the playing of music is sort of like an archiving process, or something like that.
Yeah, because, for example, that piece I played a long time, maybe 17 years ago, 18 years ago, and so in some ways, it's like your brain has an archive to remember things when you learn very, very young. So I was thinking how for a musician, archiving is still what's in your mind and what you remember. And we're used to that because we're always memorizing, you know, classical music. We start with a lot of music from Bach, and many, many times this music is written just for the instrument. So we are obligated to actually learn by memory everything, so, you know, it's funny. But when I go back and I played it for a while, I feel like I'm going back to my archive, like, remembering and how I learned or how I memorized everything and the instrument. And, you know, the whole muscle memory thing comes back. It's just, yeah.
You mentioned it was like if you go back to a good book you read or something, that you can sort of reinvest in this.
Yeah, it's kind of like, wow, almost the first time again. You know, or you remember what it was like to be part of that place the first time you were.
So, Nikki and I mock up an animation film just as a test. And we have a short test.
So these are test shoots, and also we begin, not like with the silent film, we first did it in video, so we start to mock it up, we start to sort of see how ideas are actually really going to live in the world, and again, at the very early phase.
What kind of animation are we talking about? What material do we want to use? Is it 2D or 3D or stop motion? So we kind of play with that idea, and just with materials that were around, we used and we shot. And we're just going to ask Ruben to do something with it. So, oh yeah, let's turn off that light.
this. Yeah. I liked it. Did you like it?
Yeah. So this is stuff. This was our animation about stuff.
When did you guys do that?
A couple months ago.
Yeah. In her studio.
Yeah, in Philadelphia. And we like to use tape and glue and cardboard. We have sort of a lo-fi aesthetic, as we say, that will find its way. So we stick with that. So part two.
And we'll show you another one that's different. Ready?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sari. Thank you, Nikki. Thank you, Ruben, for that beautiful piece. I like how the stage has kind of become its own archive. And I was trying to think about how to best respond, and really thinking about, you know, what are the kind of critical intimacies that our work might share. And I have experience as an archivist myself. And in a way, one of the affinities between my own work and you all's amazing and beautiful and really vulnerable presentation and work is, you know, thinking about this question of valuation, these questions of like who gets to be remembered and memorialized and even monumentalized, and what are the archives that are working on kind of the lower frequencies. And many of the archives that I work with are of people who are less remembered or unnamed, and that goes for enslaved people, the archive of slavery, which forces us to kind of rethink what the archive might be and where it might be. So for instance, thinking about the ocean as the archive of slavery or the world. And also other archives that I've been interested in are like AIDS activists. So these are all people who whose memory is scattered, and you know, a lot of times we have to kind of piece these lives together, and it's always an act of real vulnerability and resilience to do that. And I was so moved by both the kind of intimacy of and vulnerability of you all delving into your own lives in really like cinematic, musical ways. And so I thought perhaps, you know, maybe I'll try and be vulnerable and look at my own archive as well. My own record of that is a bit strange. It actually, I've been working for the past several years on what's going to be a chapbook. And my own archive is super disjointed, fragmented, and literally it's just on Twitter and Facebook. So you know, we're talking about like, you know, digital archives, that's exactly what I do basically. So I wanted to read some of my own, some work as a prelude, which means, you know, to play before. And this is emphasis on the ludic play sense. Okay, so I'll just read part of it. It's called Cruising in the End Times, which is kind of, yeah, that's just what it's called. Okay, and it'll probably be clear why. All right. Friend, happy birthday. Me. It's actually tomorrow, but thank you. Them. It is tomorrow in India. Decolonizing time is the best birthday gift. What are those empty spaces and gaps in your bookshelf, but holes eagerly waiting to be filled? Bibliophilia and slut theory and book crushing and pleasure of the text. The feeling when you're too cute for human and animal and gender binaries. Happy Trans Day of Opacity. The so-called age of trans visibility is really the age of visible absence. Trans as gender in ruins. Let's all be ruined together. What happens when we're ruined together? They bailed out the banks, but they can't bail out Big Frida. So much for trans visibility. Abolition now. The real existential question for cruising in the end times. Could you ever be with someone who doesn't love memes? I've decided to call my wayward, crooked, unruly, deviant teeth queer and to love them for it. about how to create infrastructures of life beyond romantic relation alone, i.e. thinking about the politics of friendship. My usual after a long day at work discourse with my cat, who I've moved now, so that's another archive, begins with my monologue about my day, extending into the intimacy of all my feels, and then politely requesting that the cat please don't touch that. That being whatever object of emotional significance that the cat is deciding is actually an object of cat play and cat desire. And with me finally wondering aloud when the cat will finally get a job, help pay the rent, buy groceries, and do chores around here after all. The feeling when you're signing up for jiu-jitsu so you can channel your femme rage and choke up and throw around a couple of hetero bros a few times a week without any carceral consequences. America isn't broken, it was built this way. What if Luke Cage broke down all the prison cage and border walls? We need John Brown studies, not whiteness studies. If white people like minimalism so much, why don't they just disappear? White techno-futurism isn't new. Know who else was a white techno-futurist? Christopher Columbus. White guy in Manhattan walking around with an Occupy Mars t-shirt equals peak gentrification as colonization. Now that Elon Musk is on Trump's advisory team, does that mean we get to send the white nationalist house to Mars? Bye, techno-fascism. What if we all cried at the gym? The feeling when you want to get a 3D printer to make a copy of yourself for work purposes. And this last piece is just condensed. It's called reading. Reading. Reading done generously and receptively and promiscuously. Reading as submission. Reading as non-monogamy and resisting the notion that we must be married to any particular thought style, theory, philosophy. Reading as polyamory. Haven't we all had so many lovers and don't we continue to yearn for more? Reading as insatiable desire, as taking in more than one. Reading as being more than one. Reading as scission. Reading as torsion. Reading as suture. Reading as lust. Reading as tactile, as fingering the pages with pleasure and anticipation. Reading as erotic or political. Reading as the showing of the fiction of the subject-object distinction and their actual relation of interplay. Reading as entanglement, as ontology, as being with, as becoming, as worlding, as individual, as beyond the threshold, as touching feeling. Reading as play, reading as exchange, reading as willing, reading as vulnerability, reading as opening and stretching, reading as anality, reading as whole, reading because there's no whole, reading as non-sovereign, as unsovereign, reading as virality, as contagion, reading as transmission, reading as transference, as being both analyst and analysand, as projection and introjection, reading as being a bossy bottom. Pleasure of the text indeed. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Jay. Oh, I was just going to say thank you. I really appreciate that. Thank you for joining us today. I want to invite Sari and Nikki to the stage. And if you'd like to join us as well, that would be great. Would you like to come too? We have just a little bit of time in case anyone has any questions. I really firmly believe in the idea that the only sort of productive, generous Q&A is one that honors the queue. That is to say, if you have any comments or preambles, I ask them to whisper them to yourself or save them for out in the lobby, and then right now it's about asking questions because that's the chance for everybody to participate together. So I'll model and just say I was really taken by how you you all found the archive as a place of introspection, and I was wondering if you also all hinted at the idea of institutions of archive. So what is that, what are the institutions that inform the sort of matrix of your personal archive, if that makes sense? Like, what are the models that shape how you understand an archive?
Yes, institution, no, archive, but I also think a lot about personal archiving too. Like my own experience moving to a different place and you pack your stuff and you try to decide what to pack and what to discard and what to store somewhere else and things like that, personal archive. And then if I keep this, and how long am I going to keep it? And then if I keep it forever and then I'm gone, then what's going to happen to this thing? Do that mean anything to anybody? That sort of thing is a personal level archiving. Like, why do I keep this thing? Okay, it matters to me, but after my life, no one knows what this value is. So why do I keep it anyway? Is what I often think.
I'm such an amateur in the institutional idea, but I have an image, and I always have an image, which is the Natural History Museum and the drawers of the birds and the spiders, and that's my image. When I think of an archive, just in a big general sense, I actually found a picture of this woman, woman, and she's in front of a drawer of parrots. You know? This is all of these dead parrots, there's like 40 of them, but, did a sheet long ago, actually, in the Natural History Museum. It was just an astounding, like, because it was row after row after row after row, species and extinct species, and so there's, again, to me, this real reverberation between, like, what we keep, and then in a museum or an institution, what do you display, and why do you display it, and what's topical and what's current. And then we got into a conversation of Ruben and Sari and I about the Stradivarius, the cellos, because there were very few cellos that Stradivarius made, but a tiny number, so they're of huge value. And there's a famous one called the Vatican Strat, because the Vatican owned it, and finally they released it to be sold, and it's worth like, I don't know, $500,000. Anyway, it's just a crazy...
$5 million, more like $5 million.
Yes, the story was 2 years ago, so yeah. And so the rare instrument, so suddenly the rare instrument, the conversation was, it's a place to put your money. Like, what a good place to put your money, and the rare instrument is like, that's weird, this is such a weird...
Yeah, I guess for me, my relationship to the archive has been really informed by like Black feminists who are working with archives. So that ranges from professors like Cydia Hartman, who writes a lot about the archive of slavery. So, you know, slavery becomes the institution that you're working with. And to artists who really work with the archive of slavery and think about, you know, the absences because of the ways in which people were, you know, devalued or unvalued, like you were saying. So approaching the archive is like always a process of feeling, but in this sense, it's also a process of pain. But there's really powerful responses by artists. Like there's a poetry book called Song that uses the remnants of one instance of the archive of slavery that is like a ledger. And that's all that remains of this event of the sinking of the throwing overboard of enslaved people to get the insurance by a British ship under invasion, that period of invasion capitalist. And so the poet took this artifact and you know, redid the words, like took, like literally cut and paste to turn something that was deeply, you know, depriving, like unimaginably depriving, into this magical reinvention of the archive itself. So I think I'm often in my own archival practice, like moving with archives that are uninstitutionalized, where the institutions are places of social control, so like prison archives, for instance. And the prison has a lot of power over, you know, what's accessible to the general public. So these are the kind of institutions that I work with, but also that I try and kind of amplify. Like, how are we making our own archives as a collective process, and how are those not beholden only to the large institutions that have a lot of capital?
Thank you. Are there any questions out there? Yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, that was a great performance. I couldn't tell exactly like what would normally go into your performance of this piece, like how much of your personal stories and the spontaneity of music and stuff, like how much of it would you actually perform in a non-studio visit format, and how much of it, yeah.
How much of it is a performance?
You mean the story? You mean the story itself? Let's say a sound real story.
You guys just seem so chicken at the mix. Like the structure that you presented today, that was such a mix of things. Like when you've performed this in the past, or the silent film in the past, how much of that room gets up?
Sure. So to set the scene, what you saw, the only missing element, if you will, is Tim. So when it played, Tim Fain lived in this world over there. So imagine a very tall, very white, blonde, curly-haired guy with a violin on this side of the screen, and then the Benji lived on this side of the screen. And for the third or the first two-thirds, that's the world that we're in. We're watching the film, we're watching this world unfold, and then the film breaks, like Sari said, and we move into the 1947s and then out. Sari magically changes and comes out on a bicycle with the Kamishibai stage, and starts retelling the story again as the Kamishibai guy.
With a political agenda attached to how he tells the same story after the war and under the American occupation.
And bracketing that at the beginning and end, Sari in 2017, just coming out and just sort of using me, I'm gonna tell you the story.
But maybe what you meant to ask is included, like to take a personal story into and make it into a studio visit. Like in your case, they're still making it, trying to find a story to make a theater out of.
We don't know what parts of the pieces of this particular horrific month of my life will actually be theatricalized.
And,
I know why she was really reticent to have her story told. It's really uncomfortable.
Yeah, it is really uncomfortable because once you tell a story to someone and then it becomes something to shape up into something else, and then I always feel like, no, that's not how it went, or that's not what happened. But then you step out of it and you just accept the fact that it's no longer your story, then it just becomes a work. I think it goes with any sort of art.
And to give some context, with the last show with Club Diamond, they showed just the film and just the beginnings of what did you do some of the Kamishibai as well?
Yeah.
At the Public Theater 3 years ago. And that became the impetus for them completing the work. And so it's really exciting to be at this moment to see again these gestures, these beginnings of ideas of what that animation might look like. What are the burning questions? What are the autobiographical elements? What are the philosophical elements? And how is music at the very core of the sort of compositional germination? So that I really appreciate that you showed a little bit of what that companion piece Club Time then looks like in its completed state, so that we could bridge that gap. You had a question.
I'm actually glad you asked that, because I thought it was just me trying to figure out, are these two separate projects? Is this part of a project that's already finished and talking about another project, or this all part of the same thing? The introduction left me a little confused, so I was afraid to ask that question, but now that I know, she didn't either. So then I had another question. I gather that the club film, that was just part of the performance. However, you played, sorry, I can't pronounce the Japanese word, the character of the guy
Benji.
Who tells the story. You did that in Japanese?
Yes.
Yeah, so in the performance, it's in Japanese. Mm-hmm. So then what struck me is, since there's no subtitles and most of us here don't speak Japanese, it's kind of like the opposite of subtitles. And the other thing, because you have the live musician on stage and you have the live person doing the Japanese talk about this silent movie, it struck me that you're almost like a musician. And it's not about the verbal meaning of the words, but the music, the sound that you're making, and the energy that's coming from that side of the stage in your character, and the energy that's coming over there in a musical format, is almost like going to see a silent movie where the guy comes out with the organ or the piano player, the ragtime music for the 1920s movies. So I was like loving that, and then suddenly you guys started talking, and then I was like, wait, did I misunderstand something? So thank you for it.
So no question?
Well, there was kind of a question, but they were answering the question.
Right. But an efficient question. All right. So another yes. What's that? Oh, fine. Are there any other questions
for everyone?
No. Oh, are you thinking one, Marco? You're still formulating. All right. I'll give you the time.
Just to respond to her, when I do the Benji, the narration part, I do work as a musician. I feel like I'm working with the music and silence and the visual. Like the whole component is for me to be working with as a musician.
All right, Marco.
I think I know how to ask it. I was very, thank you so much. I was very impressed to see it. Thank you for sharing. I was very intrigued or excited to hear your version of archives as music or the ocean of memories for the. It's like memories, it's very fluid archives, and you talked about institutions of archival institutions, which are very rigid. As we're thinking now in technology where everything's more fluid, your Twitter archives or Facebook, which belong to companies, not so much institutions now. We're looking at open source movements, which we're looking at. How are we looking in the future in terms of fluid collective memories or archives? And what do we keep, what do we store it? Because we used to store music in CDs or vinyl or cassettes. And right now it's an MP3. How are we looking into the future to store untangible, beautiful things like this, or other things? I don't know if it makes sense.
Can we start
off
that?
I think the technologies are changing, I think there's some really cool instances of community archives that I'm seeing that are kind of like online in this time of like digital humanities, basically. There's an archive of, I think it's called like a community archive of police violence, and it's in Cleveland. And it was local community organizers who realized that the local police, and this is true for a lot of different, you know, at the federal level, I think there are statistics, but there were, like, the LAPD, for instance, would destroy its own records, or so there was a kind of record kept of acts, incidents of police violence. So the community members were doing it themselves, and then anybody could add to it. And I think it's like just a WordPress site, which is like important for access, not only because it's not, you know, well, because anybody can the democratic process of it, but then also with something like Twitter or Facebook, you know, there's the difficult reality of it's allowing a lot of voices to have their say, but at the same time, like you're saying, they are kind of huge corporations that are having effects that are real, like gentrifying San Francisco, for instance. So it's a kind of double bind to figure out the ethics of the archive.
Well, I just want to say thank you all so much for being here today. Thank you. It's a real pleasure to be able to intersect with the work of art at this moment in time and to explode some of the ideas by inviting other artists and voices into the room. So I hope you'll join us. We have one more studio visit over in the Siegel Center, and it's starting in 10 minutes. And that's with Jamil Kosoko. So with that, and with Rizwana Bradley as the critical respondent. So we'll see you there. Thank you so much.